We have invited a special family, a special couple to come out and join us. Now this took place some 2 years ago in planning. You know, when you try to get these speakers to come in, when they have such busy schedules, you have to plan ahead. And it's exciting how Lord has blessed us to plan right at this time with so many crucial things going on in our nation and our world to get to roots that are so foundational in our lives, and one particularly in regards to marriage. And so we're excited to have the Tuckers with us this weekend in opening their hearts and their joy of the Lord and what the difference he has made in their lives and their marriage to join and to share that with us today. They come sharing with their ministries from Lifestyle Magazine and with Mad About Marriage. They have traveled all over the United States. I think if I remember right, they go to Dubai on Monday, so we need to keep them in prayer. So they have some exciting things in sharing this needed message of these valuable tools that can help us to be even more grounded and supported and united than ever before in our marriages, in our homes, and for Jesus Christ. And so, can we give a hearty amen as we invite Elder Tucker to share with us this morning the worship in the Word.
We have had a great time already here in Norwalk, in your company and your presence, so thank you so much for having us here. We are from Faithful Today Television, the oldest religious television broadcast in the world. We just celebrated 64 years of television broadcast ministry this past May. 64 years. I posted that on my Facebook page and someone asked if I was the founder. That's just wrong. I had to unfriend them right away. That's just founded by William and Virginia Fagel, whose idea was to create programming that people who would not listen to preaching would watch. And that's what we still do. Our flagship programs are Lifestyle Magazine and Mad About Marriage, and we deal with real life issues today: personal health, personal relationships, personal finance, attitudes that keep a person alive and healthy and happy. Those are the things we deal with on our programming. And we invite you to watch. If you don't have a television, go to lifestyle.org, and you can watch them right there, or madaboutmarriage.com. But that's the mission and the purpose of Faith for Today Television, and we thank you for having us here. And, of course, Mad About Marriage is one of those ministries that we engage in, because the state of affairs for marriage across North America is pretty bad. But there are some keys that if you learn and practice, they can make any marriage a whole lot better and a lot happier. I invite you to take your Bible, if you would, please, and turn to Luke's Gospel, the 7th chapter. And as you're doing that, I'm going to tell you a story. I was asked some years ago to go visit a man who was in a psychiatric facility. He was suffering from depression. In fact, had been depressed for over 40 years. 40 years of depression. That's a long time. Now, when I visit someone over depression, there are a couple of things that I look for. Of course, you know, there's the genetic causes for depression that you really can't do much about other than doctors can help medicate and treat that. But then there are other causes for depression. You think about guilt, unresolved guilt, or anger. In fact, the classic definition for depression is anger turned inward. And as I talked to this man, it did not take me long to figure out what his depression came from. It was a sense of guilt, and that had resulted in anger that he'd leveled against himself. He told me his story. Some 40 years earlier, he had had an extramarital affair. He was a young man in his early 30s and had a wife and children, but had had an affair. In fact, had left his wife and moved in with the other woman. The pastor, his family, his wife, his children all begged him to come home, and eventually he left the other woman and came home, but he did not break off contact with her, which was a big mistake. And then he left his wife again, went back to the other woman, and again the pleading, please come home, please come home. And eventually he did come home the second time. And this time he came home to stay. He broke off the affair, broke off contact. The problem is that after he came home the second time, a well-intentioned preacher, pastor, and an evangelist both came to visit him and told him that because he had gone back to the woman the second time after having left her to come home and repented, he went back to her the second time, that in so doing, he had committed the unpardonable sin and now was beyond the reach of God's forgiveness. And he believed them. Every time the church's doors were open, he was in church begging God to forgive him, but believing that God would not hear or answer his prayer, and believing that he was, in fact, a lost man. And so that anger at himself for having gone back was turned inward, and he was now a very depressed man. I told him that what the pastor and evangelist had told him, though probably well-intentioned, was a lie. It was a lie that crawled off the floor of hell and smelled like smoke. That he had, in fact, been forgiven the very first time he had asked. He said, "But pastor, you don't understand what I did." And he told me the story again. I said, "Yeah, I got it the first time. Doesn't change the answer. You were forgiven the very first time you asked." He could not believe me. And he died believing that he was a lost man. Now here's what I believe to be true about the grace of God. The Bible says if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. This man had confessed repeatedly. So, according to Scripture, he was forgiven, even though he didn't understand it. He was forgiven. And forgiveness equals salvation. If you have been forgiven, you are clothed in the righteousness of Christ, so that when the Father looks at you, he sees only the perfection of Jesus and not your sins. Therefore, with that in mind, I believe that resurrection morning, the most surprised man in the universe will be my friend. And if I know him well, as the angel takes him by the hand and he ascends to the heavens, he will argue with his angel. "But you don't understand what I did." And the angel will look at him and say, "Would you shut up? I'm going to take you to Jesus and maybe he can convince you that you were forgiven the first time you asked." That, I believe, is the message of Scripture. God is that good. His grace is that strong. His love is that all-encompassing. He loves you. That was the message that Jesus taught when he was here on this planet. Now, at the time that Jesus came, the Pharisees, the teachers of the day, were teaching that God loved the righteous, but God hated sinners. And they viewed the righteous as those who tried to keep the law. The keepers of the law were the righteous. All others were sinners. God hated the sinners while he loved the righteous. Jesus taught a very different lesson. He said that God loved sinners and that there are two variety of sinners, those who kept the law and those who did not, but that all were sinners and that God loves all sinners. Well, that was a message that was very difficult for the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the teachers of the law, the priests and all, to accept. Many of them rejected it. But I tell you what, people who were viewed as sinners heard the message and they were warmed by it. One woman in particular who was, in fact, a sinner, as she is described in Scripture, and we will see later, basically, this means that she was a prostitute. She heard the message that she was loved by God, and it began to change her life. It changed her completely. Because actually, prostitution was one of those sins in those days that was thought to be an unpardonable sin. Because in order to be forgiven, you must not only confess the sin and turn from it, change your ways, but you must also make restitution for the sin. And how would she do that with that particular trade? Impossible to do. Therefore, it was taught that that trade was in fact an unpardonable sin. That she was hated by God and doomed for destruction. She thought that there was no way that God could ever love her. But Jesus said, "God loves you." And that was a tough thing for others to hear, but I tell you what, it warmed her heart. Not only did she fall in love with God, knowing that she could be loved and accepted and forgiven, but she fell in love with the man who gave her that message, who we also know was also God. She fell in love with that message and would have done anything for him. Now, with that as the background, let's go to the Gospel, the 7th chapter, and let's start with verse 36. Now, one of the Pharisees was requesting him to dine with him, and he entered the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. Now, there's more here than what meets the eye. First of all, this story is told in other Gospels, and there the Pharisee is identified as Simon the leper. Here, we will see later, he's called Simon. But he was called Simon the leper in other Gospels, and the reason for that is this is a man who had had leprosy. Well, in those days, no one could cure leprosy, and yet he is no longer called Simon the leper. He is simply Simon. Why? Well, he had been cured of leprosy. He had been healed. Only one person could have done that. That was Jesus. Jesus had healed Simon of leprosy. Therefore, when he invited Jesus to his home, which is a very significant thing for a Jew to do in those days, to invite someone home, was to invite you presumably into fellowship and intimacy with that individual, it was assumed that this would be a dinner to honor Jesus for having cured him of leprosy. That's what the assumption was. However, as we get into the story, we find that that's not at all what was going on here. Because when you were invited to someone's home in those days, there were three things that were absolutely, positively given to you. In fact, it was expected, it was social convention, and to fail to give any one of these three things was considered to be a great insult to the guest. Item number one would be water. Water was given to wash your feet because you walked in open-toed sandals in a dusty land, but also to wash your hands in preparation for the meal. The Pharisees taught that a man with unwashed hands was unfit to even say the blessing, and so water was given in order to wash. A second thing that was given is that you were always greeted, a male guest was greeted with a kiss from the host, usually on the cheek. You were embraced and given a kiss as a welcome. The third thing that was given was oil. Oil to heal the skin from the ravages of the sun. Oil to anoint the head. You were given oil. Those three things were essential. It appears that there were other guests at this dinner, and they were given those three things because they did not turn around and leave in anger. They were still there, so they had been given the things that were expected. Jesus, as we'll find out later, was not given any of those three things. He was not given water. He was not given oil. He was not greeted with a kiss, whereas the other guests were. It was an intentional insult to Jesus. The host intended to insult him. It was not an oversight. This was intentional. It was to put the young preacher in his place. He had claimed to be a prophet. They were going to test him to see if indeed he was a prophet and perhaps to straighten out this foolish theology of God-loving sinners. And so they put him in his place by the intentional insult. It was to pay an insult of that magnitude, that nature, in this land at that time was absolutely huge. This was about as bad an insult as you could pay to someone, especially when you'd invited them to your home. This was direct, it was intentional, it was ugly. And Jesus recognized what was going on. He realized that he was being insulted thusly. He realized that he was not an honored guest. He was there to be placed on trial. He recognized that social convention had been thrown out the window for him, whereas not for the other guests. He was being singled out. And so he responded in kind, because we just read that he reclined at table. That made it himself. That was never done. If you were invited to someone's home, the host always seated everyone, and he started with the eldest. It is unlikely that Jesus, at the tender age of 30 to 33, in that age range someplace, was the oldest guest there. He was not. Some of the disciples were older than Jesus. So he was not the eldest guest there. And yet, he should not have been seated first. In fact, the host would have seated the eldest on down to finally Jesus and would have placed him someplace. But Jesus said, all right, if I'm being thusly insulted, if social convention is cast aside, I'll cast it aside as well. I'm not waiting for you to seat anyone. I'm choosing my seat and I'm sitting down now. It was a statement back to the host, I understand why I'm here. Bring it on. That's really what it was about. That's what Jesus did. Bring it on, buddy. I know why I'm here now. You've sent the insult. I know what you're up to. So, social convention aside, I'm sitting down. He reclined at table because around the table, dinner tables were usually a U-shape or a circular table. And then the couches, they were couches that were at a slope. And the high end of the couch was placed toward the table. The guest would recline on the couch, propping himself up with one elbow, so to dine that way. Usually there was a common stew pot placed in the middle of the table, a large stew pot. And then the bread was rather stiff and flat, and that was a utensil. You would tear off a piece of bread, dip it into the stew, and then eat with the bread as a utensil. You would eat the utensil. No double dipping, of course, I'm sure. But that's what people would do. And so Jesus reclined at table around that U-shape or circular table as if to say, We're throwing convention aside. I get it. I'm sending the message back to you. I know why I'm here. I'm not leaving in disgust as I should. I'm staying, but I'm also letting you know I understand why I'm here. I understand that this is about an inquisition, so bring it on. That's what's going on. Already in just one verse, we've got all that information right here when you understand the culture. Verse 37, and there was a woman in the city who was a sinner. And we've already mentioned her, and this is basically a euphemism for the fact that she was indeed a prostitute. And when she learned that he was reclining at table in the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster vial of perfume. Now, we're told in another telling of this gospel that this was very, very costly. Very expensive. Costing about a year's wage in that neighborhood. Very costly. And the question is, where did she get the money to buy this? She only had one source of income, folks. One source of income. Jesus knew that. She provided a gift for Jesus out of the proceeds of her illicit trade. And Jesus basically assumed the money was baptized. He received the gift. Even such a gift as that. That's an amazing thing in itself, isn't it? When you think about that. She brought an alabaster vial of perfume, and standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and kept wiping them with the hair of her head, and kissing his feet and anointing them with the perfume. It happened. She found her way into the house, and she witnessed the insult paid her master. She saw that Jesus was singled out among the other guests, and was directly, intentionally insulted. He was brought to shame and public dishonor by the withholding of those particular gifts. The kiss, the water, the oil. She saw that her master, the one who had told her that God loved her, was thus being ridiculed and shamed in front of the other dinner guests, and it broke her heart. She could not stand to see this man who she loved so dearly insulted in this way, held up to public ridicule. And so she said, you will give him no water for his feet? If I asked for water, you wouldn't give it to me because I am, of course, a sinner. You hate me. You don't even want me here. But you won't give him water for his feet? I've got water. It's here in my tears. And she took the tears of her eyes and began to wipe them on his feet, to wash his feet with those tears. That's the water I have. I will wash his feet with my tears. You'll give me no towel to wipe his feet with? I have hair. She did something that was unspeakable in those days. It was taught that a woman's hair was so sultry, so seductive, that she should never uncover her head in public. In fact, if a man was married to a woman who uncovered her hair in public, some Pharisees taught that it was his moral obligation to divorce her. The first time a man would ever see his wife's hair was on their wedding night. That's when she would allow it to fall uncovered. That's how sultry the hair was thought to be. Also, she would never speak to a man in public because the woman's voice was thought to be so seductive as to cause a man to think bad thoughts. And so it should never be uncovered in public. Never be heard in public. She should not speak to a man in public, certainly a man that she was not married to. So she was never to speak. And she does not speak in the story, but she does something that is just unthinkable. She uncovers her hair. She could have scarcely caused any more of a stir if she had taken off her clothes. She uncovered her hair, and then she did something else. She touched a man. She touched the feet of Jesus, using her tears to wash them. She touched him. She kissed him, giving him the kiss that was refused him at the door. And she used her hair to wipe his feet. And then, since they would give him no oil to anoint him, she used the perfume. She was reversing the insult. You'll give him no water, no towel. I'll give him my tears and my hair. You'll give him no kiss, I'll kiss his feet. You'll give him no oil. I'll give him perfume. I reverse the insult you paid my master. She did everything in her power to reverse the humiliation that he had suffered. She entered into his suffering with him and did her level best to reverse everything they had done to her master. It was an in-your-face act back to Simon, who had thusly insulted her master. Standing behind him with her at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and kept wiping them with the hair of her head, and kissing his feet and anointing them with the perfume. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, remember Jesus is there to be tested to see whether or not he is a prophet, and if so, to straighten out his theology. If this man were a prophet, he would know who and what sort of person this woman is who is touching him, that she is a sinner. Any woman who would touch him, any woman who would let her hair down, any woman who would kiss him is obviously a sinner. She's a sinner, and yet he's receiving this act from her. This is no prophet. This is no prophet. And Jesus, verse 40, and Jesus answered him. Answered him? Simon had said nothing. He answered his thoughts. He answered his thoughts. Simon, I have something to say to you. And he replied, say it, teacher. Again, we miss the impact of the statement. What Jesus said in the original language is a Jewish idiom. Essentially, what he said was, I got something to tell you that you don't want to hear, but I'm going to say it anyway. It's exactly what he said. I got something to tell you, you don't want to hear it, but it's coming your way anyway. And Simon said, bring it on. That's the kind of, this was a tension-filled exchange between these two men. Jesus is saying, you don't want to hear this, buddy, but here it comes. I'm ready. Give me both barrels, buddy. That's what they're saying, right? Back and forth to each other. That kind of tension is in the room right now. Not just over the woman's act, but their conversation, Jesus knowing, I've been insulted, I've been humiliated by you with the throwing away of social conventions. I've sent a message to you. Yes, I understand that. I seated myself at table. And now I got something to say to you, fella. You don't want to hear it, but here it comes. Simon said, I'm ready. And then Jesus did something strange. He told a story. People would ask him a question, and Jesus would say, did you hear the one about the old boy who was a pearl merchant? What? They'd ask him another question. Did you hear about the farmer who went out to sow seed in this field? What? Over and over again. But what we miss is this. A Jewish theologian in that day didn't teach by principle and precept as we would do today. The theology was in the story. And Jesus' message to Simon is this, your theology is all messed up. You're here to judge me on my theology? Let me tell you what my theology is. I've got a story for you. That means if you get your theology straight, you'll understand that what you did to me was wrong and what this woman is doing is right. Here's my theology. And he starts with the story. This is what he says. A moneylender, and by the way, there were a lot of stories in that day told by the scribes, the teachers of the law, with a moneylender. The moneylender always referred to God the Father. Always God the Father. So, here he's starting with one of their stories. A moneylender had two debtors. One owed him 500 denarii, and the other 50. When they were unable to repay, he graciously forgave them both. So which of them will love him more? Now, a denarius was about equivalent to a day's wage for a common laborer. So 500 days wages for one and 50 days wages for the other. And yet both are graciously forgiven because neither can pay. The question is, which of those two, the 500 denarii debtor or the 50 denarii debtor, will love him the most? Simon answered and said, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And he said to him, you have judged correctly. Now Jesus turns to him, and he turns it in two ways. First of all, he lets Simon see that he understands the insult that was paid to him, but he also makes the shift in the moneylender, because the moneylender is no longer just God the Father, But Jesus himself steps into that role as the moneylender. He makes it apply to himself, thus implying that he himself is God. He said, turning to the woman, he said to him, "Do you see this woman?" And Simon's trying very hard not to see her. "I entered your house, and you gave me no water for my feet." He's here mentioning the insult. "But she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but she, since the time I came in, has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with perfume. For this reason I say to you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little." He said, "You don't love me because you don't understand that you could be forgiven a great deal. You don't think that you owe much to God, that you're not a sinner. You think of her as being a great sinner. All right, so let's just say she's a 500 denarii sinner, but she's been forgiven. She's been forgiven. Therefore, she loves greatly. If you don't love me," and by the way, now he's putting himself in the position of the moneylender, isn't he? He says, "I am the one who forgives. If you don't love me, it's because you've not been forgiven very much." Why wouldn't Simon be forgiven? He hadn't asked. He hadn't recognized that he needed it. He had not recognized one very important point, and that is this. All of us are 500 denarius sinners. All of us owe a great debt. There are no 50 denarii sinners among us. Your sins may be a different flavor than mine. That makes them no less odious before God than mine, nor mine than yours. It's all the same thing. We all owe him the same amount. We owe him everything. Everything. And the message is, when you recognize that your debt is great and he has forgiven you all of your debt, your love for him will overflow. That's the message. And he was saying to Simon, "You don't understand that you are a great debtor too. You don't love me because you don't think you've been forgiven or that you even need it." Then he said to her, Jesus looking at the woman, verse 48, "Your sins have been forgiven." Now in the place of the moneylender, he turns to the woman and says, "I forgive your sins. I forgive you." Those who were reclining at the table with him began to say to themselves, "Who is this man who even forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." There are no 50 denarii debtors. All of us are 500 denarii debtors. And all of us can be forgiven. Because God loves sinners, those who try to keep the law and those who do not. He loves us all. And all can be forgiven. That's how great the love and the forgiveness and the grace of God are. He loves and forgives all. Your sin is not so great that you cannot be forgiven. You may think that you owe too much. You may think that, "But I've done this sin so many times, how could he ever forgive me? You just don't understand what I've done." The message to you is the same as it was to my friend in the first story, and the same as it was to Simon, the same as it was to this woman. Your sins are forgiven because God loves sinners. I worked for a time as a hospital chaplain. And I remember one morning I checked my calendar and I had two appointments on that calendar. One in the morning with a young woman who I did not know. She was 28 years of age and she'd asked to see me. And so she was on my appointment calendar that morning. The afternoon I was to leave the hospital and just walk across the street to a nursing home where there was a 78-year-old woman. And she was just freshly admitted to the nursing home, dying of cancer. 28 and 78. So in the morning, the young woman came in to my office, 28 years of age. She sat down. We engaged in small talk at first, and then she got down to business. She just opened up. Here's what she said. Chaplain, I've been married and divorced 3 times, and all 3 divorces were my fault. My children have been taken away from me. They live with their fathers. I've had countless affairs and broken up numerous marriages, and they were all my fault, and they were all intentional. I've done this all. My question is there any hope for someone like me? That afternoon, I went to the nursing home. 78-year-old woman. I sat down by her bed, and she wasted no time with the small talk. She went right to the heart of the matter. Chaplain, I've been married and divorced 3 times. All 3 divorces were my fault. I had affairs that caused the divorces. My children will not speak to me. My grandchildren will not. I have one niece who at times will visit me, and that's all. I've had numerous affairs and broken up countless marriages. Is there any hope for someone like me? Same day, 2 women separated in age by 50 years with the same question. Could God possibly love someone like me? The answer for both women was the same. It's the same answer that Jesus gave to the woman who was a great sinner. The same response he gave to Simon. The same response that I gave to my friend who was depressed. That's the response for both of these women. God loves sinners. And your forgiveness is secure. One prayer is done. That's his message to you today. There may be someone here who feels that your sin is so dark it could never be forgiven. Someone who fears that maybe you've done this thing far too many times for God to forgive you again. You're almost embarrassed to go back to Him with the same issue. Someone who feels that perhaps you have crossed too far. Here's the message of the Father to you. I adore you. I forgive you. Come home.